Folks, we have another amazing day today, and we're kicking it off with two mind-blowing presentations, literally. The first one is going to show some of the most amazing interactive world experiences I have seen coming from the MIT Media Lab. So I'm super excited to introduce Hiroshi Ishii, head of the Tangible Media Group at MIT Lab.
Good morning. It's really great to see so many people and the excitement. And I think ultimate display is one of the fundamental visions of Ivan Sutherland. And I feel that is becoming realities. And also this volcano eruptions represents disruptive innovations. And I really feel the strong heat of the magma that you guys are creating. It's very exciting. Also, it's great that I can see so many great pioneers in this field. Professor Mark Billinghurst and Steve Finance. Also, I met Sad Stana yesterday in the GoogleX, but all these people's effort, more than 20 years, now finally blossoming, making a real tangible like a form and the impact. That's so exciting. So I was in Milan last month, exhibiting my piece in the Milan Design Week. So that is a place to show all the furniture design. But I exhibit this piece called Transform to make a collision between technology and design. So I'd like to show first short clip of this Transform. Spending 20 minutes, I'd like to talk the ideas behind all this design and effort. So juxtaposing conflicting disciplines or paradigms really generate the opportunities of innovations. In this case, Milan Salone represents the beauty of the furniture design. But furniture is a frozen, dead materials. The beauty is the surface of the look and the feels. So I do believe machine is also beautiful, algorithm is beautiful, motion is beautiful. So we try to make a collision of technological beauties and traditional aesthetics in the design. Art and science are very profound examples. There are great impedance mismatching between value system of art and also science. That's the opportunity to make people think, to make a jump. So transdisciplinary is some very important fundamental guiding principle of our research. So finding opportunity in conflict between disciplines or paradigms. Also breaking down old paradigms to create a new archetype, new paradigms, is something very important practice. How many people speak German? Sprechen Sie Deutsch? Oh, great. Okay, so Aufheben is the closest word, the philosophical word of Hegelians. Conflicts then go to the next dimensions. So Aufheben is something very important to fuse art design, science technology, and also business. To make Aufheben, most important thing I do believe is a vision. Of course, most of people are the geeks who love technology and hate technology, but technology is just an enabler, necessary condition. It shouldn't be the goal, it just means. But most of technology go to the landfill in 2 or 3 years. Users' needs also constantly changing. How much effort you do for the listening to the customers or anthropological study or user studies, you never get the hint of the next quantum leap. So vision really drives like ultimate display of Ivan Sutherland or Barnaby Bush Memex or Dagen Elpert's collective interest. These are most profound, important stuff. The reason simply lifespan. you have an amazing machine in your pockets or lap, but unfortunately, most of the stuff are gone to landfill in 2 years, even if it's functioning, because you want to get more fancier one, faster one, because advertisement fire up your desire to get new one. That's a capitalism. Application also constantly change, needs changes. So listening to music, LP, CD, MP3, cloud streamings. But the vision, strong visions may last much longer than our lifespans. That's something I want to produce, I want to leave behind. So this is a summary of my battles against Pixel Empire in past 20 years. Pixels so powerful, still mainstream the pixels. So in the left side, you see the iceberg under the water. So iceberg is the information. You can see the information through the surface waters or thick glass, but you can't touch it, you can't reach it. You have to use remote control, mouse, keyboard, or even touch screen. Touch screen is not allow you to touch information, just surface of the water. But the information is bottom of the pools. So how to bring up information above the water to make it graspable, tangible, blur the boundary between representation and controls is the first challenge called TangiBits I started 18 years ago. But I got stuck because atoms are so shy and frozen. It doesn't dance. Even under the water, computation starts dance. So that I decided to hack materials, atoms, to make dance. So that's radical atoms. So spending, 18 minutes, I'd like to compress my battles against Pixel Empire in the past 20 years. So my interest is how to represent information. Representation matters. If you represent idea in mathematical logical equation, then you can apply all the mental operator of logic, linear operation. How many people are visual thinker? Good. So you sketch ideas. Then you can have a holistic view. You can spatially move around information. The physical proximity of the icons represent a lot of key important information. That's another way of representing of information. So understand what's the impact of digital. Best place to go is the historic scientific instruments museums, where you can find all the beautiful artifacts, like orari, like this one. This is a great representation of the knowledge of the solar system based on the scientific discovery of all the scientists. But the beauty is the interface. You can see this handle. This handle is a port to jack queen to your body. When you move the crank, you are the part of the machine or system. There's no ambiguity about the causal chain, about why four seasons exist, why eclipse happens. Because your muscle, bone, nervous system, jacked in to this representation of universe, in this case, solar system. That's a beautiful impedance matching, which completely missing today in a GUI, separation, decoupling. So digital is very powerful, but so decoupled from a physical world. Many people did RFID, GPS, all that stuff, but it doesn't really bridge this gap seamlessly. That's why 18 years ago, I started TangiBits. So pushing information above waters. So the above water, you see the white part. That is something you can really grasp and manipulate. So that becomes controls, direct controls with tactile feedback. So embodiment of digital information and computation so that people can directly interact with their hands is a key idea. It's simple to say, but to materialize is a very, very struggle. But I presented the first vision paper in 1997 in CHI, and it's very difficult to get those papers accepted, almost rejected. But I was so fortunate having Mark Weiser, Dr. Mark Weiser, father of Epitas Computing, in the committee, and he saved these papers, saying this is a kind of the vision paper of computer science of the 21st century. So I'm so great that he helped me to start this project. First, I'd like to show the classic project called the Music Bottles. Thank you. And the great thing is this also inspired many people and became a product to helping medications. So elderly people can't remember all the medicines they have to take after dinner or before dinners. But if you don't, if you forget to open the bottle, that reminds the patients, or report to medical doctors, or report to pharmacy, so pharmacy can send a message of refilling. But also kids living far away also get a message, so your dad is okay. So, but this project came from very, very personal reasons. I had a dream to give a present to my mom, who lived in Sapporo City, north part of Japan. And when she wakes up, she wanted to know the weather forecast of the day. And she usually watch TVs, 7 a.m. TV, to see the... But instead of the watching TV, I want her to open the blue bottles near her bedside. So today's a fine day. The reason is she never touched any machine, any computer, any smartphone. But she opened soy sauce bottle many, many times to cook for me. So that's warm, familiar metaphor of the world. So how we can design the system using those metaphor, providing power of internet information, is one of my dream. But she passed away in 1998. Other reason I put the music instead of the weather forecast into the bottles. And also in the same year, my great friend and guru, Mark Weiser, passed away. So that this is a tribute to my mom and Mark Weiser. So I'd like to show another example to show the iceberg, tangible bits. How many people saw the movie, Minority Report? How many people know Dr. John Kofra, my first PhD student, is behind this movie? Okay, he's a guy who invented so many amazing concepts, emaciated pixels. Also, he started Oblong Industries. How many of you know G-Speak, gesture interface? That's all the inventions of his team. But let me show the app.
Herp is our most complex, comprehensive application. Herp is our most complex, comprehensive application.
So this is for urban planning.
Intended for professional use.
So you have all the information of the buildings and the city.
Herp employs wireframe
under the water or in
computer.
But the portion of information, in this case, building, are physically embodied.
These projective shadows are carefully
inviting you to grab
and
manipulate
to the base of each architectural.
Then shadow. It's not optical, but computational shadows. So you can see that all the digital shadows follow the movement. And also the clock, now sub, as an inverse input device. Every display can be also inverse input devices. So now you can really explore inter-shadows between the...
In this case, an architect or urban planner responsible for the new structure on the right must worry that it may occlude the existing left building's morning sunlight, which indeed it does in this position. But experimenting with possible solutions simply means grabbing a building and trying out a new location.
Oops. Also, you can see that
comprehensive application to date, cool. And is again intended for professional use into the workspace to engage the same.
This also allows you to do the shadow simulations. For example, let me show.
Herp is our most complex.
I think how many people are mechanical engineers
provides a good qualitative
who solve Navier-Stokes equations? We love Navier-Stokes equations. So every time you move the buildings, the boundary condition is changed. Then it's fed into the engine under the waters, then recalculate. But you can use two hands or six hands if you have three colleagues. Also space multiplex. Now I have a mouse, I have a full controls, I dominate my screen, but this is more democratic and horizontal. Multiple people can directly manipulate. Also, this is real 3D, not a fake 3D through 2D screens.
It's
also tactile, there's no ambiguity when you grab, move it, no ambiguity. Even there's a latency of the digital shadow follow. So that's a very interesting alternative to VRs or AR. So also clay, and the sand are very powerful media of form giving. But how many people are artists? Oh, good. How many people are designers? Good. So I think form giving is something very important. So we use the clay, also sand, as a medium of form giving, but also turn them into the computational media. So let me show the soundscape we exhibited in Arts Electronica. So if you sculpt sand for the beauty aesthetics, immediately computer capture the geometry. These are water drainage, vector of the water running down. Speed show, the color show the speed, so you can understand the potential erosion, for example. You can do a lot of stuff, form giving for beauty aesthetics and computational analysis together with same sand. That's a tangible bit. That's a media, multiple inheriting from power of the tangible physical materiality and computational powers. So you can really compute water drains or shadow. So you can decide which slope you should plant the flower or tree. Do they get enough sunlight over the years? Or if you remove soil, where you may reuse it to maximize the economical like aspects like that. So this left brain thinking and right brain thinking can happen together. But there's a problem. This sand or clay have no memory. Once I change, deform it, it can't restore. Also, my building in up has no memory. It's frozen. It's dead. I can't change the shape or height of the building, physical building, on the fly. That sucks. That's the reason we started to go to the next level of radical atoms. Because computation is powerful, but atoms are so shy and frozen. So we have to hack atoms so that atoms can dance. Because pixel can dance. How many people write a program code? Good. If you write a code, you're the queen or king or prince or princess, you can make all the pixels dance behind a thick glass. But all the atoms, like this podium or plastic, never dance. So I want to make a new material called radical atom that's dynamically transform, conform, and inform. So first endeavor is a shape display. It's very low resolution, but Daniel Reitzinger designed these systems. They develop a lot of different interaction techniques. And of course, you can directly manipulate push or pulls, but also you can develop new language, like a midway gesture, to issue the command in wide area of these pins. But the more important thing, redefine the meaning of the rendering. Rendering means pixel on the 2D screen. But you can now render information in both physical tangible and also pixels. But both are strictly synchronized. One thing manifested in two different forms. So if you manipulate, this is now traveling through the time. Imagine erosion or mountain building. You can go back. You can also directly manipulate. Then immediately you see the change of the shape, direct manipulation or midway gesture. So we are inventing a new representation of information and a new interaction of the spectrum, which nobody ever really explored seriously. So relief was very low resolution, but we made the next jump called Inform last year. So I'd like to show the video. This video got, I think, more than 2 million hits. How many people saw this video? Oh, good. It's the power of the internet. So this telepresence is just one of thousands of possible applications of radical atoms. But the reason we use telepresence is we care about the body, embodiment. And you guys know all the teleconference, Skype, or Cisco's high-end stuff, but all the pixels. Also, there are amazing robots, telerobot operations, master-slave robots, but it's not really embodiment. But here, using a very popular technology, scanning the physical shape, but then re-render physically in a remote space. Now you can really manipulate all this stuff directly. So let me first of all, life is so short. Also presentation time is short. But this is an important moment. Intermaterial interaction. This is not a display, although we call display. It's more than displays, machine, robotics, to move the things, because there's a mass, so that it can really move anything, including a smartphone, to grab your attention. You know the affordance, doorknob or GUI, but now imagine all the surface of your physical environment transform. They can provide totally different dimension of affordance or guiding. Also having a very, very precise sensor and actuators, you can simulate any physical properties, force feedback. It can be very soft or very hard or whatever. This is an important moment that you see information travel from iPad to the shape display, but still exists in both worlds. Most important, information is somewhere, but there, just manifested in two forms. Now you see those mathematical equations, but now you can put ping pong ball on the curve, so you can really estimate, understand, using a naive physics. This is an engine we took 2 years to develop through trial and error. Daniel Leitzinger and Sean Forma put a lot of energy, but the outcome is quite exciting because this lead pipe looks like a blood vessel. Also, this is another example of the artistic expressions we started to explore. So, oh, thank you. Thank you. I'd like to show one of the artistic kind of the examples to show the potentials of this clips. One moment. Oops. So now you see the relative motion of the maze and the balls, and you can project your life into the lead balls in a corporate maze or whatsoever. But so this is one of the expressions. Don't ask me why. This is art. Yeah. So also we are exploring different approaches than shape display. We're also doing a lot of the soft organic materials. I want to show one of the examples called NUI, using pneumatic transformations, printing all the layer of the transformation structure in advance, and using air as a trigger to make desirable transformations. This is a paper, we got the best paper award in the last, I think, WIST conference. So now this is a lamp. It's transformed into the energy saving stuff. Also combination of hybrid materials like elastic or non-elastic. You can do a lot of interesting transformation pre-programmed. You can't change the pattern of transformation on the fly, but still you can make a lot of the interesting interaction, making these materials tightly coupled with a sensor and the display. Now you can see multi-layer of different pattern appear, also fine resolution pattern of the haptics, which may really empower, like a steering wheel, for example. Also, we are developing the process of fabrication, because you can't 3D print these kind of stuff. So we are refining lithographic process, inventing all these kind of crazy, messy materials. But it's great, everybody now making stuff. So maker movement really encourage those kind of stuff. So these are another examples of the approach to the radical atoms. So now I'd like to show the final clip. So transform is a challenge to the conventional notion of design or furniture. But for us, the possibility of the new level of expression, which nobody ever seen before, is something very important. So now you see all the patterns. But this is fully computer program, of course. You can make it interactive, or you can prescript it. But this is a scenario that the machine is envy about nature, which God designs. So they try to emulate the aesthetic of the wavy motion or water, for example. That's the beginning of the story. Also, machine made the cities and the architectures. This is an interaction. You can energize the wave. So this is a city, ancient cities, pillars and the walls and the castles. But this turned out to be the sand castles submerged under the waters, like Atlantis. This is a dance between new materials, radical atoms, white materials, and old materials, red balls, dancing together. So these are small examples, but these are kind of an invention of the, say, paintings. It's a white canvas waiting for the creator, like you guys, to paint with a new story. And I'd like to thank to all the amazing students and the colleagues who work so day and night to develop, materialize our vision of radical atoms. So to summarize, it's very important to really be transdisciplinary. So contrasting different fields or juxtaposing different principles is so important. Art design, science, technology, and also wearable, organ realities, and those all important concepts, but not necessarily compatible. So incompatibility is opportunity because they inform each other through the collisions. but also it allows us to transform into a new level, upheaval, new dimensions. But maybe most important things, you have to really inspire people. To do so, it has to transmute beyond any preconceived expectation. That's a very important goal. That's a dimension of the art. It's not a technology, not a science. So the future is to predict, but to future is not to predict, but to invent. It's a famous word of Dr. Alan Kay. But to invent the future, I do believe the vision is the most important engine, but not all, because we have to envision the really exciting, desirable future, meaningful futures. Vision matters. Barnabas Bush mimics. Doug Engelbart's collective intelligence. All this vision is such a powerful driving force. But we have to build. We are engineer. We are technician. We have to use software, hardware, everything. Embodiment is important to test the ideas. But in the end, our stuff we're building shouldn't go to landfill in next year. It has to really keep inspiring people. To inspire people, we need this level of aesthetics or profound message to make people think. That's a dimension of the art. So it's great to be here to see amazing moment that many years of research of organ realities, wearable computing, are finally blossoming. And I have a plan of in the near future, 2050, I go to a bit more higher altitude. One of my students said it could be also negative space. It depends on my behavior. But anyway, but the most important thing is all together in 2100s, no exception. unless you're a cyborg. But the important thing is the future. Future never ends by your happy retirement or death. It continues to exist. So question I'm asking to myself, my students, also my colleagues, if you're a builder, if you're a maker, what do you want to leave for those living in 2200? How do you want to be remembered? So I want to leave my vision, if that's survive. So 2200 is a bit symbolic numbers, but that implies the future never ends by our lifespans, but continue to exist. It's eternal futures for which we are responsible. So thank you very much for your kind attention.
Thank you so much, Dr. Ishii. It's such an honor to have you here today. It's really, I hardly have words for it.